website, worldfootprints.com, where you can peruse our library of radio shows, articles, and more. You can also find links to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. At World Footprints, we like discovering and sharing little-known travel treasures. One of those is the American Whiskey Trail. Todd Pittock is a contributor to the Saturday Evening Post. He toured the Whiskey Trail, which runs from Mount Vernon to Bardstown, Kentucky, and he rediscovered the rich heritage and deep roots in our nation's history along the way. Todd, welcome.
Good to be here.
Tell us about the Whiskey Trail. Exactly what is it?
The trail itself was started by the Distilled Spirits Council of America, which is a trade group, to promote the idea of American whiskey. But what they set up a route that runs basically, as you said, from Washington up through Pennsylvania, down to Kentucky, and actually all the way to Tennessee, with a lot of neat stops along the way at distilleries. You know, and so as you go, you're really narrating a very interesting, you know, episode in American history that, you know, carries on to this day and that, you know, you can visit and taste.
This trail takes us into states like Maryland and Pennsylvania and then westward to Kentucky. And so it does kind of follow, in a sense, kind of the national road. But talk to us about the importance of whiskey in really the development of industry and commerce in our country.
You know, you have these whiskey distillers, which was a big part of American life in in Pennsylvania. And I guess maybe it's a good point to talk about where, what that brief history is. Well, it's actually quite a long history, but we'll tell it briefly. The distillers were busy in Pennsylvania. The government, the president at the time was George Washington. Washington imposed a tax on distillers. That was the first federal tax, and it led to a rebellion known as the Whiskey Rebellion. The irony is that George Washington then started making whiskey himself later, and became very successful at it. The whiskey, because of the rebellion, the whiskey distillers fled Pennsylvania, and that's actually why we associate, then they wound up in Kentucky and Tennessee, and that's why we associate those areas with whiskey today.
How do people learn about American history, and was this trail, self-guided trail, created because America failed to tell its whiskey story all these years?
That's a great question. I'm going to start with the second one. There are people who really feel that we didn't tell the story of American history, the story of American whiskey, very well. And this became a way, as with all trails, it becomes a way to narrate, the history and to at each distillery as you go from place to place. Now, I'm going to answer your first question alongside it. There are great resources online. There are books along the way, and they're often sold in the gift shops of these places. But each of the distilleries talks about their own piece of the story, and I think that's how you learn it. You're also seeing these fantastic landscapes. In terms of telling the story of American whiskey, I guess there's a lot of ways to do that. What interested me was the history, right? But then there's also the story about what it is. I think that it's been seen as, because we have bourbon, we have Tennessee whiskey. Those are distinct American styles. And there are other styles. I mean, this is also part of the whiskey story today, is the resurrection of old recipes.
Are there places along the trail that are essentially relics and artifacts and buildings that are no longer used that are important to telling this story as well that people can see?
As I said, the first one is Mount Vernon. That's pretty much where they started the tour. And that's obviously George Washington's house and the distillery. And the interesting part of that story, that piece of it, is just that they excavated the distillery and then they started making whiskey again from that distillery. It was dormant for a long time. But obviously, it's not just about whiskey. The trail goes up into Manhattan. It goes up to the Francis Tavern Museum, which is where Washington bid the troops farewell. There are, you know, there's Gatsby's Tavern in Alexandria, Virginia. You know, it's a historic building. So it's not only whiskey. So there are some places, by the way, there were places that I didn't visit myself along the way, including the Oliver Miller Homestead in Pennsylvania. And I don't think they're making whiskey there.
This is World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick. We are enjoying a bit of whiskey and a taste of American history with Saturday Evening Post contributor Todd Pittock. Visit worldfootprints.com for more information about America's whiskey trail.
What's happening in the whiskey space in terms of these regional whiskeys and the growth of this craft distilling around whiskey?
The artisan craft phenomenon is happening across everything, right? And it's certainly happening in whiskey, too. You know, and there again, there's a little bit of history, right? So you had, prior to Prohibition, you had hundreds or more of distillers, and they were making their own stuff. There were guys who made, you know, whiskey in mine shafts, and they used all kinds of. There's something called sugar shine, which is made the base of it. It has a lot of, I believe it's cane. And so these recipes, when Prohibition came in, all these places were shut down. And when Prohibition ended, the industry was dominated by a few big companies. So now, all the way, you know, all this time later, it's only beginning to recover and get back to what it was, which is this incredibly diverse, you know, world of whiskey. You know, what got me interested in this particular place, in addition to the fact that the trail was there, was I kind of wanted to go back to the places where it's been anchored and kind of started, you know, and held its own all the time. But now you're seeing whiskey made all over the country, you know, and really, really neat, fun stuff.
Todd, I want to clarify, just for our audience benefit, that when we're talking about the whiskey trail, it's not in the same vein as talking about a wine trail with regards to tastings. Because I understand from you that there are tasting regulations.
It's a funny story, actually. Jack Daniels is in Lynchburg, Tennessee, and it was only relatively recently that they were permitted to offer samples. And, you know, until last year, 18 months ago, Lynchburg remained a dry county. They never had enough people there to overturn the regulations that dated to Prohibition. Kind of an irony, considering it's the most visited whiskey distillery, I believe, in the world. I know it's the number one selling whiskey in the world. So yes, I mean, depending on what distillery you go to, you may or may not be able to taste, because the rules differ from county to county in these places.
Todd Pittock is a contributor to the Saturday Evening Post. He wrote an article about his adventures along the whiskey trail. Sip your way through American history along the whiskey trail. Find out more at discus.org/trail or visit this show page at worldfootprints.com for a direct link.
In this destination spotlight, we learn about the diverse offerings of Belize from Althea Sebastian at the New York Times Travel Show.
Belize is in Central America. We're bordered to the north by Mexico, west and south by Guatemala. English is the official language, but due to our close proximity to other Central American countries, Spanish is widely spoken as well.
Tell us about some of the cultural influences that have made up Belize over the years.
Okay, well, as you may know, Belize was once home to the Mayas. We still have a lot of Mayas living in Belize to date, and we have one of the most extensive cave systems in Belize. We're also the largest concentration of Mayan archaeological sites is located in Belize as well. Belize is what we like to say is a melting pot of cultures. Besides the Mayas, we have the Garifunas, we have the Creole, we have the Mestizo, we have the East Indians, we have over like 7 different cultures in Belize. In Belize, we like to say you get the best of both worlds because we're considered the Caribbean, but we're also Central America. So you get that unique, authentic feel. We have the inland adventures. Besides the beach, we have the inland adventures where you can go do the cave tubing, the zip lining. We have the different waterfalls. I mean, culturally, we have the Mayas. They have the Maya homestay program where guests can go in and spend a day or a couple hours with a Maya family. It's a very authentic educational experience where you go in, they take you into the cacao fields, you pick the cacao, they bring you back home, and they teach you how to make chocolate from the cacao. So it's a very, very educational and neat experience.
How would one find out about that program?
Well, you can visit our website, www.travelbelize.org, and there's a link on there that you could get their contact from.
I'm a diver, and I understand from other divers that Belize has one of the most beautiful dive sites in the world.
We do, and of course we have the Blue Hole, which is an avid site for divers. It's 412 feet deep, very, very pristine, very adventurous, you know. So you can go in and dive the Blue Hole. Diving is great because we also have the second largest barrier reef, so the water is very pristine, very colorful, a lot of fishes, you know, a lot of wildlife, sea life.
His new book, The Founders at Home, The Building of America, 1735 to 1817, historian and City Journal editor Myron Magnet tells the magnificent, intimate, and intertwined stories of our founding fathers, their successes, flaws, and inspirations. The Founders at Home provide a unique glimpse into the architectural influences that shaped their homes, lives, and visions of self and our nation. Myron, welcome to World Footprints.
Oh, Tanya, it's a pleasure to join you.
So I understand that you actually have your wife to credit for this accidental inspiration to write this extraordinary book.
Absolutely. She'd gone on a road trip with my son, and they, among other things, had driven down to New Orleans through the back roads of Mississippi and came back with the most astonishing story. She said, you know, we could go on a road trip, too, you and I. I said, oh, I don't know. And she said, well, you know, we could go to Virginia and see the houses of the Founding Fathers. You'd like that, right? I mean, you love architecture. You love the Founders. And I thought, all right, you know, what could be bad? And it turned out to be a complete conversion experience for me. I walked in, especially to Monticello, and was floored. And you understand, I was more than 60 when we did this. And how I mean, I've seen the great houses of England and many of Europe, but I had never been to see the houses of the Founding Fathers. And walking into those houses, it's like walking into the minds of the guys who built them, and they were, like so many 18th century gentlemen, amateur architects. So these are really personal artistic expressions of their inner longings and their ideals, and you get such a, I mean, you know, you know this. You walk into Monticello, and the intricate floor plan, you know, all the demi-octagons and the rectangles all fit together. I had to have a blueprint in my hand just to figure out what was he doing here to make everything fit together. And the thing that strikes you after a while that's really notable and strange about the house is that it is flooded with sunshine. He's got these floor-to-ceiling triple-hung windows and louvered skylights everywhere. I mean, very technologically advanced was Jefferson. And so you finally get the sense that the whole house is like some Enlightenment shrine, and is crying out, as Goethe was supposed to have said on his deathbed, more light. It's just the most beautiful and striking thing. And, you know, he became very young, a widower. So it really is like a bachelor pad. He had his slave, Sally Hemings, living in a room in the basement. And that was another thing that struck me about the house. He had, I mean, this is a whole...